want to introduce you to our next breakout speaker, Jonathan Benjamin. Jonathan Benjamin is a serial entrepreneur, and it started way back by selling candy at school at the age of 10, all the way to opening a superhero-themed cafe and an online custom t-shirt website at the young age of 25. He was then able to sell his first storefront business in 24 short months after single-handedly promoting and marketing his brainchild. His passion for creative marketing was kindled. Nearly 5 years ago, he became the co-owner of an automated marketing company based out of Tampa, Florida, called Pulse. He does small business consulting, and he runs a mobile website optimization company. After attending the Seattle Train the Trainer in January, he ran workshops and became a trailblazer by May. He is doing the financial abundance mindset from Ruin to Rolex. And one of the reasons he's doing this is he's one of the people that is talking all about the financial mindset. I know for me, he's one of the people that when I'm sinking down into some negative limiting beliefs, he's the first person to call me out and build me back up. So I'm very excited personally to introduce to you, Jonathan Benjamin. Please come to the stage.
Everybody can hear me? Pretty good? Okay. I am going to talk about the abundance mindset, and I'm going to specifically talk about money. So if anyone has a problem with that, you should probably stay, because we're going to fix that. Does anyone have a problem talking about money? Does anybody have a problem with money? Does anybody have all the money they want? You might already have all the money that you want, but we're going to fix that too. The abundance mindset, and I'm going to get to why I call from Ruin to Rolex in a moment, it's about your thoughts. And this is an IP principle where, you know, our default setting is to thrive, not just survive. Too many people are just surviving. And it's important to have that mindset, because you really can't expand in all the ways you need to expand, both emotionally and spiritually, unless you have all that you want, and you have a certain level of income that allows you to not worry and not stress about the next bill or the next thing, or food in your stomach, or, you know, the electric bill. It's very important, because how can you possibly grow and expand if these things are constantly looming? As Regina mentioned, I own a few companies right now, and they've all become quite successful, thank God. And maybe some people would think, like, well, maybe it's a lot easier to have a level of an abundance mindset if you are already abundant, or financially abundant, or at least more so than someone else. And I suppose it's a little easier to maintain it, but I still came from a place where I didn't have it. And maybe many of you, or people that you're going to be teaching in your workshops, are already there, or there. I'm certain you're going to come across people that are there. But 5 years ago, I didn't have all those things. And in 2008, I think it was, you know, when the whole housing market crashed and just everything kind of fell down, I was working in the automotive industry. And when banks stopped buying loans for people, car dealerships stopped advertising to get people in the door. So we get them in the door, we can't get them into a car, so what's the point? So my wife and I both got laid off. We worked for the same company, and we didn't work for over a year. Watching your wife literally leave the house with holes in her clothes is a place you never want to be as a man. And I'm certain that the women here don't want their husbands like that way either. And I felt at the pinnacle of this, and we didn't work for, like I said, over a year. At the pinnacle of this, I felt like if she were to get swept off her feet by some guy who's rich, then that she deserves that. And if I can't make it happen for her, then someone should. And that's a really rough place to be. So I'm going to teach you guys what I did to fix it. And she didn't leave, by the way.
Smartly.
No one can rise to his greatest possible height in talent or soul development unless he has plenty of money. For to unfold the soul and to develop talent, he must have many things to use, and he cannot have these things unless he has money to buy them with. This is fundamental. And it's not about just having money to throw around and act like you're rich and be a big shot. Rich is way more than that. Being rich and having money is way more than that. It's not about just having fancy cars or fancy things. You're adding value to yourself, and you can add more value to yourself through things. And you can add a tremendous amount of value to your family and to your friends and the world around you. Does anyone know who said this? Yes, he did. Does anyone know who Wallace Wattles is? Raise your hand if you don't know. And this is interesting, and I'll tell you why. I'd be willing to bet that he is a catalyst for you even being here today. He's a catalyst why we're even in this room right now. And the reason is, he wrote a book called The Science of Getting Rich. He wrote it it was published over 100 years ago. And the reason I say that it's possible that he led you here is because Rhonda Byrne, who wrote The Secret, read this before she was inspired. This is what inspired her to write The Secret. And I'd be willing to bet that The Secret is what got you all of you here. And if it wasn't, it was Mike Dooley, and he was in The Secret, and that's what got him, a little more well-known. So, ipso facto, this guy got you here. So, thank you, Wallace. The reason he said this is because we all have desires in our heart. We all have passions and goals, and these were put in our heart on purpose. It's not put there so you can never think about them and not achieve any of them. They're put there so you can achieve them. You would not have a certain desire or passion unless you were fully capable and worthy of its achievement. What a cruel world this would be if you had all these things you wanted to do and all these passions and desires in this world just for you to never have any of them. Right? It's every day just dream about these things that you wanted and never actually get them? Come on. What's the point? It's not going to happen that way. And it shouldn't happen that way. Unfortunately, it does happen that way for a lot of people. So we have to change the way we think about things. The card you're holding in your hand, I want you to do this really quick. Write down how you feel about money. And give it a quick thought. We're not going to take too much time, but a quick thought. Because it might be, and it's okay if it's negative. It's okay if you've got some weird belief about it. That
anybody needs a pen with their hand?
Perfect. Thank you. Anyone brave enough to shot one out?
Elusive.
Say again?
It's elusive.
Elusive.
Yeah. Buddies will say thank you.
Grateful.
Money flows.
Distracted. I love money.
Money is fun.
Comes to me in expected and unexpected way.
And does it?
My favorite.
One of the things I always say, yes?
I think money is a neutral tool that allows freedom.
100%.
It's energy.
Mm-hmm. Money is neutral. Thank you. Mm-hmm. It's neutral. My hand is neutral. I could beat someone with it and hurt them, or I could love somebody with it. I could hold a baby. It's neutral. It's what you decide to do with it. It's a tool, and it's neutral. And people don't think that and don't believe that. If you love fine food, you should have as much fine food as you can handle. You deserve it, you're worthy of it, and you should have it. If you love fine art, you should have as much money as you can possibly get your hands on to enjoy as much fine art as you possibly can. I don't care if it's flying to all the wonderful museums all over the world, or just buying it yourself and hanging it on your walls and staring at it all day long. If that's the way you feel connected, if that's the way you feel love to expand, you should have it, and you're worthy of having it. You know how I know you're worthy of having it? Because you're breathing. Because you're here. Designer clothes, anything. For me, it was watches. And I like watches. And I always wanted a Rolex. Now, you just heard how I was about 5 years ago. And that is not the level you need to be at to be buying Rolexes. Stealing them, yes. Buying them, no. And so I got to a level, and I'm gonna, and the, there's some things I'm gonna teach you just in a moment of how I got there, to where I was in the position where I was buying a Rolex, and bought it for cash. And I'm not talking about credit cards and making payments on. I bought it because I wanted it and I had the money to do so. I went home, and it hit me pretty hard. And I always had a level of self-worth. And I think that just like a lot of things, you know, like an onion has layers, even our self-worth, there's multiple layers within of our self-worth. We might think we're worthy of a cheeseburger today, maybe we're worthy of a steak today, and some people think they're worthy of filet mignon today, whatever it is. But the deeper you go and the more you level up, you're gonna hit challenges and it's gonna press you, it's gonna shake you, and it's gonna be very uncomfortable. And I got home and I was very uncomfortable, and I never felt that feeling before, not like this. And I, at first I mistook it, I thought it was buyer's remorse. I was like, oh, maybe I shouldn't have done that, you know. But then I thought about it more. I'm like, no, because I had the money. I'm not missing that money. There's still plenty of money. And I even asked my wife if she wanted one. I said, hey, we get the woman's one with the diamonds in it, you know, whatever you want. She's like, I don't want a Rolex. But then I realized that I had won the wife lottery because she didn't want a Rolex. I'm like, that's fantastic. I'll buy two. No. So then it wasn't buyer's remorse because it wasn't necessarily about the money. And it was a feeling. It was really sad feeling. And I wondered what it was. And through some, you know, introspection and talking to some people, I realized what it was. And it was a level of self-worth that I had not really accepted or allowed for myself, even though I thought I wanted something. And then I got it, and it didn't feel like I was worthy of it. I was like, what's that about? So it was deep. It was really, really deep. And I'm sure I'll feel it again one day. And I hope you guys all feel it too, but push through it, because I know what that feeling was. It was the place that people get to that they self-sabotage or they retract back. And I don't want that for anybody. And I know that I almost did. And I, you know, consider myself a very, you know, outgoing, powerful, I can do it, I'm gonna do it, I'm gonna have a person. And if I can feel that, anybody can, you know, anybody can and probably does. So, what's up with self-worth? To have that level of abundance and that mindset, you just can't get there from here. Maybe you can, I hope you can. But sometimes you can't. And there's a reason. That's the reason. We don't believe it. We don't really believe it. Maybe to an extent, but not deep. Not deep enough. Or maybe we haven't been put in situations where we can feel it that deep yet. It's important. Because you only have access to the realm you believe you belong in. This is one of my favorite quotes. It's the truth. It's a fundamental. You can't be running with the CEOs and hobnobbing with these people if you don't believe that those are the circles you belong in. I'm gonna make everything available at the end, guys, so you don't have to take notes crazy. What realm do you believe you belong in? We all want to be in different realms, possibly than we are currently, or another level up from that realm. But do you really believe you belong in it? And you have to believe with every fiber of your being. Why don't we? If I asked every single one of you, you'd say there was something that you didn't have yet that you wanted, that you were trying to achieve, that you had a goal. Why isn't it being achieved? Why can we manifest parking spots at the mall right up front? But we can't crack the money nut. And I've heard that so often, not only in my workshops, but also at these conferences. I'm like, what? Do you think there's a difference? Do you really think there's a difference? The universe has some sort of levels of things to give you, and it's easier to give you a parking space than $10 million? Not. It's not. It's the same thing. It's infinite. We believe that, right? We've got something in our head that's kind of changing what we feel. 7 plus or minus rule is the idea that we can only really control about 7 plus or minus 2 thoughts going on in our heads. These are the ones about, got to go to the store and pick up milk, and I got to get the kids from school. I have a dry cleaning to pick up. And it's also the ones that we're trying to control to stay positive. I'm happy, tree falls in your way, I'll go around, I'm supposed to go down this road, maybe I'm supposed to see something cool, I meet the love of my life down this road. So we're trying to stay positive on those 7 plus or minus 2. And some of us are doing an excellent job at that. It's not where it's at. You can get somewhere from there, but not everywhere from there. And there's a reason for that. And it's because scientists say we have 50 to 60,000 thoughts going on in our head. Subconscious. Auto-programming. It's going on in the background. And some of it we don't even realize what it is or what it's saying. That's powerful. 50 or 60,000 is really powerful, and they're probably no match for the 7 or 9 you can control. We your subconscious mind is betraying you. Not all of you, some of you, many of you, and at least on some level. And there's reasons for it. And there's probably a lot of reasons for it, but what I'm gonna share with you are the reasons that I found in my life, and there's probably a ton more, and you have your own. But some of these might resonate with you too. Culture and media. Do you guys believe that culture and media is depicting businessmen and CEOs as good, moral, ethical people? Every time a business gets slapped with any kind of fine or new law, it's like, boom, yeah, get that big bad corporation. And I'm not saying that every single one of them, you know, isn't top notch and upright. Some of them maybe are, not doing things ethically and morally. However, it doesn't translate to every single person who's in business or every single business owner or CEO of a company. But that's the way it's depicted. And this kind of stuff, it seeps into the fibers of who we are because it's been around since we've been babies. Movies. What's always the top criminal? What's the villain? He's the CEO in a high rise. For the last 20 years, it's been. You know it. When they pan up the building, you know it's at the top. Guy out there, I'm going to burn down a rainforest so I can get the land, and I'm going to shoot the Indians out, and I'm going to kill people because I want their job and that company, whatever, right? When's the last time we saw an ethical, upright, and moral businessman in a movie? Jimmy Stewart? It's a Wonderful Life? How long ago was that? I haven't even seen the movie. That's how long ago it was. And I'm a movie buff. So it happens there. It definitely happens there. Religion. And I don't know how many of you are religious or were raised with any kind of religion or in church. However, some of the things I'm about to tell you, you probably heard even if you weren't in church. Money is the root of all evil. Heard it? Okay. First of all, money is not the root of all evil. Okay? It's neutral. We just talked about that. It's neither good nor bad. And if it was the root of all evil, that would mean if you had $100 or $1,000 or $1,000,000, it wouldn't matter. It's still the root of all evil, right? But apparently we have no problem with a few hundred or a few thousand dollars. We all at least have had that or have it now. So if it's the root of all evil, then you're evil now just for having any of it. It's not true. Not only is it not true, it's misquoted. It's the love of money is the root of all evil. The love of money. We've all seen what that can do. We had the dot-com, the bubbles burst in the 90s. It's a money grab. Everybody trying to invest quickly to make a lot of money quickly. Quick money like that, I mean, it's a money grab. We just saw it in 08 with the stock market and the housing crash. Everybody's grabbing houses, buying them, flipping them, right? It's a money grab. It's like, get rich quick. It's a money grab. It's the love of money. So people are building their whole lives and foundations about thoughts about money based on things that are being misquoted. How about this one? A little more random, but you might have heard it anyway. It is easier for a camel to get through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Anybody ever heard that one? Mm-hmm. That one's not misquoted. that's the way it's written. The problem is, people hear that, and they don't do a whole lot of searching and translating from Aramaic to Greek and all these different languages that the Bible's written in. And the eye of a needle, if you hear it like that, man, you'll walk out of a church or wherever you heard it, like, man, eye of a needle, camel, not going to happen. Which means if that would be easier for this to happen than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, then rich men are not supposed to, obviously it's impossible for it to happen. But this is another one that just people don't get, and then they build their whole lives around thinking that way. But the eye of a needle was not a threat in needle. The best way to describe it they would close big gates to the cities at night. And if you came after that, the only way to get in was like a little archway about this high. And there's some profound meanings to it in general, but for the sake of this argument, a person would have to take all their bags and the saddle off the camel, push them through the hole, push all the riches through first, crawl through, grab the reins, and drag the camel through. The camel can fit, he just has to squeeze a little bit. He's got to do a little shimmy, and you might have to do a little shimmy. I think the lesson there, maybe this isn't the only lesson, but I think the lesson there is that just be careful. Might be a squeeze. If you allow a lot of money to change you or to allow you to make choices that aren't upright and ethical and moral. So the point is just, it might be a little squeeze, but you can do it. You might have your own from your family. I met a trainer in Seattle, and she was always told after she touched money to wash your hands. Money's dirty. Wash your hands. Money's dirty. Very dirty. Wash your hands. Stop touching that money. Wash your hands. Now, they meant physically dirty, like dirt from the ground, like don't lick your shoe, you know, that kind of dirty, which my kids do, little savants. So, but hearing that so often for so many times for her whole life, it turned into money dirty, money bad, money don't touch, just this weird cloud of a negative stigma around money, and that she went all through her teenage years, and it wasn't even about money being bad. It was just them saying, wash your hands before you eat. So you might have stuff like that. I know other people have said that they hit roadblocks mentally or in their belief system when they were making more money than their parents, or a sister, or even a friend, or a spouse. I know I felt it. I dropped 5 figures on a Rolex that was costing more than some of my friends' cars. Depending on which blue book value book you look at, it's probably worth more than my car, but that's another story. And we all have different backgrounds. You may have seen your parents fight over money all the time. Maybe they were just fighting all the time. You thought it was about money. It wasn't even about money. But if you took it that way, you know, you poison the root, you poison the fruit. You got to go back down to that level, of that foundation to build from. Research shows that by 18, the average TV viewer has seen greedy businessmen or CEOs in movies and television commit over 10,000 murders and countless other illegal activities. It seeps in. How do you think about money? We always have to be thinking about that. And I know what you're saying. You're like, those are just movies. Those are TV shows. That's not real, they're actors, it's for a story, it's for entertainment purposes. But then I would bring you to this slide. You cannot roll around in the mud and not get dirty. Some things cannot be unheard. Some things can't be unfelt, especially if you didn't even know it seeped in. If someone poured poison water in a plant when you weren't looking, it still got the poison. So we need to remember that there's some things that we need to maybe dig down a little bit. And we may be dirtied up from it. So let's get clean. One of those other beliefs that you might think is that someone has to go without for you to have abundance. Or there's a piece of the pie that if you take a bigger piece or get a bigger piece, someone else isn't going to get one. Not going to happen. Abundance expands proportionally with the desire that people have for it. Always, forever, and it always will. You get yours, they get theirs. They will. So we got to drop that one right there. What are our thoughts about money? I call it the white picket fence principle. And the reason I call it that is in a story. There's people out there that have been chasing mediocrity. And they find themselves later in life with a level of mediocrity that they don't understand and wonder why they weren't more successful. So it goes like this. You go to college because you were told to, or your father did. You get a degree and you get a job and you work your way up the ladder a little bit and you get $50,000 or $60,000 a year, 401k. You find yourself 40, 50 years old, you know, house, suburbs, 2.5 kids, a dog, and a white picket fence. And that's all you've ever been thinking about. And you have it. But then you watch these other executives and the CEOs pull up in a Ferrari or have a bigger mansion or go on these lavish vacations and you wonder, man, why aren't I more successful? Why? Because you got exactly what you were thinking about. You got exactly what you were talking about. You followed a path and you achieved it. The problem is, you just didn't make it big enough. So we have to think about how we think. They were shooting too low. People shoot entirely too low. No one ever achieved some massive goal of success and went, oh man, I really overshot that. Ooh, I landed way over here in $3 million. I really only wanted $500,000. They're like, heck yeah, let me bump it again. What are we speaking about money? The things that come out of our mouths. I'm guilty as charged, I do it too. I do it way less than I used to, but I do it nonetheless. I say things like, I can't afford that. I can't do that right now. I don't have the money for that. I'm really gonna slay you on this one. I need to manifest the money to do that. Do you realize that's coming from a standpoint of lack? Yeah. You're not talking about manifesting money. You're talking about the fact that you don't have any. It's not where you wanna be. It's not what you wanna say. You're gonna get just what you asked for. How more simple could it be? Ask for what you want, and don't talk about things you don't want. Shitty things. I have friends who are like, so I can't say anything negative at all? I wouldn't. Well, how do I talk about all the shitty things that are going on in my life? Why do you want to talk about the shitty things that are going on in your life? Well, just because someone asks me how I'm doing, I get with, don't say anything. And we'll get to that in a minute. There actually is a way to talk about challenges that you're going through, and I'm going to talk about that in a little while. The BS principle. It's not called the BS principle because the principle itself is BS. It's called the BS principle because the person that I learned it from, those were his initials. He will maintain anonymity. He was talking to me, he was going through a really hard time financially, with a job, a lot of ways. And he just didn't understand. And you guys are going to come across people like this too. If you felt it before, you might feel it. You might be feeling it now, but definitely in your classes you'll see it. And he just felt like he couldn't get ahead. And he's like, I'm a good dad. I'm a good father. I'm cheating on my wife. I'm good to my kids. I work hard. I go to church. I tithe. I'm generally a good person. Where's mine? Why aren't things happening for me the way they should be? I don't ask for much. I don't need to be rich. I'm not asking to be lavishly wealthy. I just want to have just enough. That's too much, just enough. I just want to have just enough. Just enough. I just want to have just enough. Three conversations with this guy in like a week. And I said, can I be really blunt with you? You're probably not going to like it. I keep hearing you talk about yourself and what you have and what you don't have. And you keep saying you want to have just enough. Right, I don't need to be rich. Okay. I would be willing to say that you have just enough. No, that's the problem. I don't have just enough. Really? Are you hungry right now? No, I ate. Okay, that's good. Sucks to be hungry. Are your kids hungry? Have your kids eaten? Yeah, they're good. They have clothes on their back. Yes. You have a house, roof over your head? Yeah, place to go tonight, shelter? Yeah. AC on? We live in Florida, so that's very important. Electric bill running? Well, I mean, so far, but who knows next week? Right now, do you have AC in your house? Yes. It sounds to me like you have just enough. Now, I know what you mean when you say, I don't need to be lavishly wealthy or, you know, millions of dollars. I get that. I hear you. I'm a human. I get that. Universe doesn't. It hears exactly what you say and gives you what you say. So change what you say. Because the BS principle is BS. How do you act about money? What are your purchases saying? Or your lack thereof? Are you denying yourself every good thing? Every go like this. And squeeze. Like, just give it a, like really put some tension on it, okay? How's that feel? Feel good? Feels like you're in like receiving mode from the universe, like everything's gonna be amazing and wonderful. No, like this. Feels much better. Many people are living their life like that. And specifically in their purchases. And I'm not saying go, you know, match your credit cards out so you can have nicer clothes. I'm not saying put yourself in a position that's gonna make you worse off, not better off. But just don't scrimp on every little thing. Allow yourself something. I started valeting my car well before I should have been. I'll tell you that much right now. And that $20 that it cost to valet was missed at the time that I was doing it, but I was acting as if. These are all the steps I took in that 5 years of wondering if my wife was gonna take off with some more money than me to buying a Rolex. And something really amazing happened with that. Valley started becoming free everywhere. And not a lot of people knew it because it wasn't like they were putting up free valet. Some did, but most didn't. So here I am valeting my car everywhere. Even my friends were like, man, look at him. You know? And even if the parking spot was like only like a rock star parking right there, valet. Why? Why? The mindset to me was that I valet. That's what I do. My wife deserves that. She's gonna get to be valeted. And so I took that mindset even well before my physical reality showed that to me. But I trained it. I trained it into my subconscious mind. And we're going to talk about more of how to do that. Don't describe the world around you. Define it. Excuse me. The other way around. People are always saying, well, this is happening, and that's happening, and this is happening, and this is what for the... That's being reactive. We need to start being more proactive. Use your words to define your world. Get on the other side of that fence. Start saying the things that you want. People are gonna think you're crazy. No doubt. I'm not saying that they're not, so don't do it in front of other people. It pisses my brother off to no end. The thing that I said the most that pissed him off was, I have more money than I know what to do with. And I said it out loud in my office. It wasn't like in front of a lot of other people. In my office around my employees, and they would all giggle and laugh. And when I started saying it, certainly my physical reality did not depict that scenario. Pissed him off. It's very important to use your words the right way and to police them as much as possible. And we all know this. Mike teaches this. We've read it, and we know it. But really, on a deeper level, it needs to be there. The other day, I paid for some soldiers. They were Starbucks, and I saw them. And I appreciate my freedom. I'm all about it. And I don't like war, but I sure like my freedom. And if we can figure out a way to maybe balance that out, I don't know. But they were in uniform. I saw one, so and then I saw two, and then I saw three. I'm like, oh man, if I pay for one, I gotta pay for all of them. And I was already out there too. It was like, oh man, your whole brigade isn't here, are they? You know, get your credit card out. So I threw the 20 down when I paid for mine, and I said, this is for them. And that day, I found 20 bucks in the parking lot outside the Apple store. And it was funny too, because I was getting out of the car, this person parked really close, and I'm like, you know, about to curse them out in my head. And I'm like, squeezing out, I'm like, I can't believe you parked so, hey, 20 bucks. Thank you. So the point is, don't hold it so tight. Don't hold it so tight. You have to let it go for it to come back. You have to. When I started the company, we had a couple other partners, and we opened the doors. I mean, the grueling search of going to get it, the company financed. I mean, you want to talk about acting as if? We were showing up to meetings with investors asking for hundreds of thousands of dollars, and I couldn't afford the meal at the table while we were asking. And many times they picked it up, and I was like, oh, thank God. That would have been awkward. We had a business plan, and here's the revenues that are gonna be coming in, and we're going to give you this much. You're going to be, you know, make a lot of money off us. All right, here's your Coke, sir, $1.95. Hey, man, can you get this? That would have been weird. So we acted as if. We kept it going. We kept pushing as hard as we could. Well beyond what many people would have. And you have to. One of the partners, once we got it launched, it was so grueling that we were like, wow, my wife said it to bed. She goes, we finally made it to the starting line. It was so grueling. That, I mean, that should have been kick your feet up, be CEO, and be rich. And it was nothing. We had an office with some furniture in it. That was it. No product, no clients. Now it's time to get going. And three of us pushed really hard to try to get clients and build wealth. And one of us was spending most of the time downgrading her lifestyle. And don't get me wrong, budgeting is very important. But if that's all you focus on, you're only going to get it trimmed down so far. At some point, even if you own your house and own your car, you're going to have to pay insurances, food, there's gonna be things. You're only gonna get it down so far. Ultimately, you have to build more wealth. You have to have more coming in than going out. That's what you have to do. And she did that, and it didn't work out. So don't do that. There is a book called How Rich People Think. And it's an incredible book. And there's all these different points of the way people think about things. And he says average versus world class. Don't think poor, don't think, this is not a, you know, throwing jabs, but it's a mindset, and I want to show you just a few of them. Average people believe that rich is a privilege, and world class believe it's a right. It is your right. We just talked about that. You want something, go get it. It's your right to have it. Truly, it truly is. And you're worthy of it, and you're deserving of it. And as soon as you accept that, you're gonna have it. Average people think rich people are crooks. We talked about that. World class feel that rich people are ambitious. So go be ambitious. Most of the greats were very ambitious. Average people worry about money. How many of you have worried about money? It's coming from a standpoint of lack. We've all done it. But it really is. And worrying doesn't do anything except for steal your joy from today. It doesn't fix tomorrow. World class dream about money. Dream about it often. Dream about all the things you want and all the things you can have and all the people you can help. The best way to help others is to just be successful yourself. The best way to motivate someone is not to light a fire underneath them, it's to light a fire within them. And the best way to do that is to show them by doing. Am I saying don't be charitable? Absolutely not. I am. Just dream big. Average people think money is earned through labor. World class knows that money is earned through thought. I'd be willing to bet everybody here agrees with that one. Everything starts with thought. Every little thing, anything that ever happened started with a thought about it. Average people see money as a finite resource. World class see it as an infinite resource. There's no end to the abundance that's out there. And it happens through creation, not through competition. So be a creator. Be a conscious creator. Deliberate creator. Deliberately create the things you want. Average people earn money doing things they don't love. That's also a problem. You gotta get passionate, you gotta have enthusiasm, you gotta have energy. That's where it's at. World class get rich following their passions. There's two choices you have if you're not passionate, or if you're not working a job or doing something that you are passionate about. One, get real passionate about it. Just make it up, fake it till you make it, just go. Trust me, someone's gonna notice. And I've never seen anybody file cabinets with that level of enthusiasm. You must really love filing cabinets. I'm just gonna do the best I can with where I'm at. So yeah, I'm gonna be enthusiastic about that. Or your other choice is go follow your dream of the thing that you already are passionate about. I'm not saying quit your job tomorrow, but just start moving generally in that direction. That's what Mike says. Move generally in that direction. We all have different passions and different goals. Follow yours. All the most successful people did it doing something they loved. It's very hard to be very massively successful at something if you're hating it all the time and bitching about it all the time. I just don't see that. So there's the fix. Those are some of the fixes. I'm gonna get into some, those were like kind of the little ones. Now we're gonna get into some other things that I did to change everything around for myself. Auto-suggestion. Say the thing that you want to be or have to yourself often, out loud. If you think people are going to think you're crazy, then don't do it in front of them. Do it in the mirror. And do it often. It's not okay just to come to a seminar once in a little while and then you get all excited and your vibration's high and you get all energized. And then it's got to be every day. Tell it to yourself. Remember, we're trying to get our subconscious mind back on track because it's messing us up. All the time. It will believe it. It will believe it eventually. You brush your teeth every day, then you can do this every day. Morning, noon, night. Say it to yourself. And say it in the present tense, please. It's not in the future. It's now. Passwords. Change your passwords. Change them to something amazing. Change anything. Anything you type all the time. Change it to something incredible. Abundance, prosperity. I am rich. I have all that I want. I am loved. Whatever it is, change it to that because you're typing it all the time. I got a buddy who uses his wife's name as all his passwords. All he talks about is that girl. Even when we try to get out, it's great, he loves her and they have a great marriage, and that's great, but we're trying to go through some other places and do some other things, and you know, with coaching and business consulting, and it always ends up talking, and he realized that. He's like, you know what, every single one of my passwords is her name. Which is fine, that's great, but now you've got her. You've got her now, and I'm sure you're not gonna stop thinking about her, so let's change them to things you do want. Let's keep leveling up to the next level. Let's get some stuff you don't have. Let's not stay plateaued. Note cards, and we're gonna do an exercise later about note cards. I have one in my pocket all the time. And on it I wrote kind of an end goal. It's not a short-term goal, it's not like a this week thing. And it's who I wanna be and what I am. And it's said in that way, in present tense, what I am. This is what I pull out and read to myself all the time. But what's really cool is every time I put my hand in my pocket to get money or get my keys, I feel it in there. I'm touching it. And I know what it says. I don't have to pull it out and read it. I know exactly what it says. I'm going to become it. So that's very important. Ladies, put it in your purse. You'll at least see it when you're digging through your purse. Those were the little things I did. Those are the little things anyone can do and should do consistently. One of my sayings is I'm a money magnet. A money magnet. And every time money comes to me, I say that because I'm training my subconscious mind to open that evidence folder of me being a money magnet and put positive evidence in there of that because it's looking for some negative stuff. So I keep saying it every time things happen. Auto-suggestion is really important. adding a zero or two, how much money do you think is a lot of money? This is an important question. If you're the kind of person who, man, I really, $250 on a dress, could I, should I, maybe I shouldn't, I'm not gonna, I got bills, I got things like that. Probably means that you think $200 or $250 is a lot of money. Now, if that's the case, and you've got $10,000 or $15,000 or $20,000 in the bank, maybe 401k, maybe savings, whatever it is, think about what your subconscious mind thinks about that. You may already be there. Your subconscious mind might already think, $200 is a lot, we have $20,000 sitting in savings. That's, if $200 is a lot, that's millions. That's a lot of money, and we already might be there. Change it. Add a zero to how much you think is a lot of money, mentally. Change it. You'll see yourself go from when you thought $20 was a lot to spend right now to $200 is a lot to spend right now to $2,000, $20,000, $200,000. It will change, trust me, mentally add a zero. Give yourself a present by talking about everything that you want as if it's currently happening in the present time. You're not going to be something. You're not going to have abundance. You are abundant. You're not going to be a public speaker. You are a motivational public speaker. You're not going to train people. You are training people. You are a teacher. You do have the dream job. You are traveling. Present tense everything. You'd be surprised how many times you write something down and you didn't present tense it. Actually, by the way, to the end, or not said this before we did our note cards, I bet you a lot of people would have put it as kind of a future goal of that I'm going to be or something's going to happen. You've got to train your subconscious mind to believe it's going on now. It's looking at past, present, and current physical reality to try to manipulate how you're thinking and how it thinks things are going on. So you need to bring it back to that everything is going on that you want right now. Broken chairs. I talked about how there's a way to talk about bad things or a challenge you're going through. Broken chairs is the way to do it. And this was actually the friend of mine that said, how do I talk about bad things? And I said, well, you can talk about the broken chair that just broke in a way that you're talking about the new, wonderful, beautiful, comfortable, amazing chair that's gonna replace it. And that is how you talk about a broken chair. So if you want to talk about your challenge, talk about the answer. Talk about the future time when it's not going to be a challenge anymore because that's the first, because you are not like that anymore. The thing isn't currently going on anymore. So talk about it in regards to the opposite of what you want. And you can probably talk about it, but try to avoid this at all costs. Rhonda Byrne, who wrote The Secret, wrote a book called The Power. Anybody familiar? She says, talk about things that you want and love more often than you talk about things you don't want and don't love. That's the key. It's simple. You might not be able to flip the script right away, but at least tip the scales 51%. You can do that. If you find yourself speaking and talking about something that you don't want or you don't love, stop it. Start talking about something you do love and you do want. That's the way to do it. It's the simplest thing you would think, right? We all get caught up talking about things that are quite negative. Give more and go bigger. We talked about giving. We talked about how it's hard to receive if your hands clench really tight, right? You have to give to receive. And not only that, you have to be able to receive. Raise your hand if you're a horrible receiver. But probably a pretty good giver, right? Isn't that sad? Give. Someone tries to give you something. Oh, well, I don't know. What, you've been giving? There's a lot of people in this room that have a lot of stories, incredible stories, of being given something. And the people that I know that are telling these stories, I know they're givers. I know they give more of their time and energy to so many people, but can't accept a little gift. Sad part is, if someone's very wealthy and spends some money on you or does something for you that's financially they're not even gonna miss, it's quite possible that your time or energy invested in something you gave was worth well more. Can't get time back. Money flows. You're money magnets. Money flows. And to the people that give like that, flows to them easily. Time, it's another thing. Energy, Yourself, passion, you can't get that back. It's a lot more investment. So give more. If you want friends, be friendly. You want smiles, smile. And if you want money and you want financial abundance, give. Don't hold on so tight. Go bigger. Some of us are shooting way too low. At the old company I worked at, before we launched Pulse, we would have never been taught or trained. We sell automotive advertising, and we usually sell it on a dealership level. So the general manager of the dealership, or maybe the owner of the dealership. We would have never been taught to go after like district managers of multiple chains, or the marketing director for AutoNation or Penske, where they one decision would be like 30 stores that you got signed up, not one. We would never been taught that, but that's what we did. And it was something really cool happened. Not only did each yes we got become sometimes multiple yeses for multiple stores to where we closed more deals, but it seemed that these guys weren't getting called as often as the guys were making the decisions on the store level, which I wouldn't have thought that. Plus, when I first got into it, I would have thought I'm way too green. Like, these guys are, you know, way up there, they know more about the industry, I might just sound like a little, you know, peon calling them. We flip the script so much that a lot of times these guys call us. Turns one answer of a yes into multiple yeses. So go bigger, think out of the box. What can you do differently than everyone's doing? They're not, as some people think they are. That is not a curse word. That is not a bad word. That is not a negative word. A lot of people have a problem charging for what they do and for their services, especially in the IP community. I hear it a lot, how much do I charge? Or, hey, that's too much. You are not your customer. Because you might not pay or couldn't pay $125 for a workshop, for a 1 day, 6 hour workshop, does not mean that people around you that are gonna buy from you can't or won't. You're not your customer. Don't worry about your money. Don't worry about your spending habits when you're making your classes. Build the value. Add in more value. If you really have a problem with it, Johnny gave a great option where you charge 150, but you tell them 50 of it's for their favorite charity, something like that, and maybe they paid at the end. But build the value. If you have trouble, bring in lunch. Spend half the money that you took in on lunch for the people. All of us have spent more money than we intended to spend on something, or that we could have spent on something, because the value was built. Does anyone in here have an iPhone? Or a Mac or an Apple computer? Okay. We all know that you could have a phone for way less than that. But the value was there. For some reason, the value was there. Apple computers, they're 6 times as expensive as going to Best Buy and getting like a little computer. Do they have a problem selling their computers? There's a line, they have to hire security at release dates to keep the people back, and keep them in line. Build the value, add more value in. It's you and you're worthy. And you can do it. And they'll come, and they'll pay, and they'll tell people, and refer people. Anybody ever go out to breakfast? Yeah? You know you could have cooked some eggs at home for far less. I went out to breakfast 2 days ago with my wife before I came out here, and it was me and my two kids. My kids are 5 and 15 months, so they don't eat that much. And it was $50. But the experience of going out to eat with my family tipped the scales of value for that experience, for the money. Every time you go anywhere and buy anything, you're all here. You're spending money right now. You're not at work. The value is here, so you spend the money to get it. So just build the value. And there's profit everywhere. Every time you buy anything at Walmart, guess what? There's profit in there, right? The Waltons aren't just keeping the doors open and the employees pay. They're making profits. The gas station's making profits. The clothes you're wearing, you purchased them. Someone made profits off those. It's not a bad word. Strike it from your vocabulary is a bad word. You just flew across the country for a conference. There's a lot of money being made on every step of the way. You guys can make money too. Is that a bad word to anyone? Selling? Sales? Salesman? It does have a negative connotation in many ways in this country. It's not. Everything is sales. All the examples I just gave, apply them to sales now instead of profit. Somebody had to sell them to you. Whether it was them putting a sign on the outside of their building, or some people actually have a sales team going out and trying to get sales. But it is not a bad word. It's not snake oil you're selling. It's not Jack's Magic Beanstalk beans. It is an amazing way to change someone's entire life. Can you put a price tag on that? What's the price? What's the price of being completely awakened to everything you can have? What's the price tag to learning exactly that everything you've learned is wrong and you can do it a totally different way? Easily with your thoughts. What's the price tag on that? For someone who's miserable and struggling and doesn't get it. You're selling that to them. You are trading your services and adding a lot of value to their life. That's what sales is. It's not someone taking something and someone who's left hurting. There's con men that do that. But that's not what sales is about. It's about giving someone the antidote to their ailment. You're walking. You want a car? We got cars. We sell cars. It's hot out there. We have AC in our cars. Buy a car. You have a problem, they have the answer. Without buying clothes, you'd be naked. That would be a problem. You'd get arrested, probably. That's the answer. It's trading of services. It's a tough one, I know. Because people that are rich are thought of in a horrible light. A friend of mine was driving, he's dating a girl, and she has two kids from a previous marriage. And they were driving through Davis Island, which is a really nice area. And he's about 12 years old, he's like, hate rich people. He's like, really? Why? They have all these things, all this stuff. Yeah? And? Maybe they gave a lot of value for it. Maybe they traded a lot of value with their product to get that. I'd be willing to bet they did. I know Bill Gates did. He made everyone's life better. We hear things all the time like, he'll donate to a charity or someone of that level will donate. It's like, oh, good thing they're giving something back, finally giving something back. What, from all the taking they've been doing? Seems to me that in enhancing everyone's lives with the computers and the programs and all these things that make us email our family miles and miles away, or allow us programs to build things and create and have companies, that's a high level of value he's been providing to every single person on a massive level. Trust me, he's been giving back well before he gave to charity. Given to everybody. But that connotation there is that he's been taking. Once again, the stigma negatively on CEOs and very rich people. It's not a bad word. It can add a lot of value to your life. It can allow so much. It can allow you to do so much and be so much. Gotta be a little selfish. It can be a bad word, I guess, in the right context or the wrong context, I guess. But what can you do for someone else if you're not doing something for you? Got to be a little selfish. Be a little selfish, just to the point where it gets you to where you need to be to help others. Make yourself amazing. People will see it and they'll become amazing. You can't push anybody up. You have to pull them up from above them. You gotta be there. Any questions about that? Anybody's very quiet in here. Anybody get anything from that?
Lots.
Yes. Yes.
Now the reason I'm going into a marketing, kind of a resource marketing portion of this, is because once we get our self-worth and some of these negative beliefs out of the way and start training ourselves, it's gonna apply to teaching IP. It's gonna apply to selling and teaching whatever business you have, whether it's this or another business or side business. And there's some things that we've done in the past that have been, you know, quite lucrative. And I'm gonna show you guys, and I'll give you a chance to kind of get these resources through email, but some of the things that we did, and they were pretty incredible. One of them specifically is this, I'll talk about in a moment. But be unique. Be unique. In probably every industry, there's a lot of competition. Be unique from everything from your business cards to the way you do things. I gave some business cards to David, and I wanted him to show you guys some of them, so you guys can pass them around. There's a couple different things about the business cards that are very unique. Now, some of them are a little pricier than just going to, you know, something somewhere online that gives you, you know, a couple hundred or a thousand business cards for $10. And that's fine. If you just need to get something to go on, get something to go on. But what I'm talking about spending that little extra, it's being unique. The cards I'm handing you, there's two separate ones, depending on which one you have. One of them has what's called spot UV on it. And spot UV is like that shiny UV coating they put on to gloss cards, but it only is in certain areas. So it makes that area really shine and really jump off the page. It's not that expensive.
Yeah.
Just pass them around. The other one that has me in the superhero shirt is called Aquafoil. It's metallic ink. It sparkles when you look at it. Foil. I'll send it to you. When you hand someone a card, it is your first point of contact and connection with them usually. Make it unique. Make it stand out. Make it curious. What does that even mean? So they have to contact you to find out. Whatever that thing is, be unique. List building. There's companies like MailChimp, Constant Contact, we've all heard of them. Build your list. Collect everybody's email addresses and build your list. It's solid gold. Your list is gold. The person who's gonna buy from you the most is someone who's already purchased from you. Way easier to sell someone who's already purchased your product or paid you for something than go find, you know, cold call and try to teach someone what you do. So build a list. I can help you guys and send you all the links to different things, show you what I do. When you're doing e-blasts, make those unique as well. And what I want to show you is we do videos and we green screen them. I drop in like cool backgrounds and we send them to our dealers, our car dealer clients. And prospective clients. Some of them are, you know, aren't clients yet, but we have thousands of people on our list that we e-blast about every 10 days. And we talk about the product, we talk about results and other dealer testimonials about our product. And when you talk in front of a camera, you mess up. You mess up a lot. And what I did was I put all of those mess ups into a blooper reel. And then I was thinking about sending it out to our clients. Now, this one, I wavered. I wavered on it. You know, I thought that, what if they think it's unprofessional? What if they think we're unprofessional? And I said, what if it shoots us in the, what if it's a bad thing? What if we look like jokers and idiots in their eyes? These videos became the highest click-through rate and open rate of all our videos. These guys almost never respond to our videos or to our e-blasts. You know, they call us later or you connect later, but not right when we do it. We got so many emails back, and it would just be a one line, funny. Like one line from like an owner of a dealership. We never get responses like that. And it turned out to be a really, really great idea, and I embedded one in the video for you guys to see. You might not understand some of the lingo that's going on. The greens, it's raw. It's in the green screen room without the background, and the green screen dropped out, so you'll see it's how raw it is, but we send it out like this. Usually we run our videos, and we've updated this logo from then, but we used to put sales, traffic, service, retention.
Hi, I'm Natalie Benjamin, and I'm Crystal Suarez. Sorry, I gotta make a button. Hi, I'm Natalie Benjamin, and I'm here with Crystal. And we're here reporting live from your local competition. Well, with some aggressive lending. I don't want the research, Natalie. Well, our research shows.
Yeah, I get better, better.
Keep dancing while you're choking.
Go, go, go.
Local dealership.
No, we're not.
Local competition.
Damn it! Well, our research shows the dealers are reporting. Snazzy scales? Oh! Don't buy on the spot! Yeah. Now, Crystal, what's going on? Sorry.
And now a few words from our sponsor.
That's right.
When we're on, we're on. All
right.
When are you going to get on?
We're on now.
And yes, we sent that to our clients. So you see why I was a little hesitant. It worked out very well. Everything we've done creative has worked out very well. Everything we've done out of the box and unique has worked out very well. It'll work out that way for you. And you'll hear about it. My brother-in-law, I did his cards, and I did them in the foil style, that real metallic ink that I showed you guys. And every time he hands his card to someone, even if they don't know what he does, they're like, man, I don't know what you do, but if you do as good of a job as you did on these cards, you're hired. That's the mentality. And that's why you should take the extra steps on your cards and your marketing to be very, very unique and different. Everybody knows what Facebook is. So I'm not going to talk about Facebook, but there's things you should do on Facebook if you're marketing your business or your IP class. And the first one is post a photo. Don't just talk about things. It shows that photos get clicked on 53% more. They get 53% more likes, excuse me, and comments. Ask people to share that picture that you post. If you ask them to share it or ask them to click, they do it at a rapid rate. They are 7 times higher share rates when you say, hey, da 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 da, share this. Please share. Get shared. Ask and you shall receive. It shouldn't be a tough one, but it is. We don't ask for it. If you don't ask, you don't get. Use a picture that describes or defines or shows something interesting about your company or your business. Write something on the picture. I use Photoshop. I learned Photoshop. Some of you don't use Photoshop. There's a website called PicMonkey. It's free. You can upload photos there. You can use some of their stock photos, and you can type on top of the pictures and download them. You can use those if you don't know Photoshop. If you have an iPhone or an Android, I don't know if this is for Android, but on the iPhone it is. It's an app called Over, O-V-E-R. Same thing, you take a photo from your phone and you can write on top of it. So you can make your own very unique images. So use those. Pinterest. There's more people buying on Pinterest right now than Facebook. Pinterest is where people are purchasing. That's where you need to be if you're not. You don't have to do it right now, just kind of keep it in mind. And if you're doing it, do the same thing. Use a picture, make it unique. Write something very interesting on it. And make it an odd size. If you look at Pinterest, you see a lot of little square pictures. Then you'll see like a very long vertical rectangle one. Use that size. Because I guarantee you it's gonna stand out on the page. And make it a clickable link to something that you do. Your website, your product, whatever that is. Don't let it go nowhere. These are not real advanced, but these are things that you should be doing if you're going to be doing those social networking and marketing that way. And the final thing I wanted to tell you was that whatever you want, whatever that is, whatever that looks like, whether it's business, whether it's speaking, whatever, look at the people that are already doing it and being successful at it, because success leaves clues. Look for the clues. You'll find them if you're looking. Thank you very much.